we're filming this event so that those of us, this happy family, the Southern Maine Conservation Collaborative, can catch it on our website. And it's a really, really exciting topic to me. It's very compelling for so many reasons that we all know. But for us specifically, as we've been, you know, listening to conversations nationally, locally about the changing environment, water really seems to rise to the top in a lot of different ways as an issue that needs to be kind of addressed, and also a way to really engage all sorts of people. And there really is such a connection to water here in Maine. So I want to thank the University of New England for providing this space, for the food, for signage, great signage out. It's really a treat to be here. And I really want to thank our presenters, who we will hear from shortly. And I thank all of you for attending. The evening, we're a little behind schedule, but shouldn't be a problem. We'll proceed that we'll have short introductions, and if you could share your name and the group that you represent. And then the presenters will give about a 15-20 minute talk. They have PowerPoint presentations, and we will keep the questions to clarifying questions after they present. We're going to have each of them present, and then we'll have discussion. So if they're bigger questions, write them down so you can share that after all of the presenters have gone. And then we're going to dig into discussion about, you know, basically sort of why you're here, what your group wants to learn, what it's done, what's important to your individual organization about water, and then take it to the next level and talk about the idea of collaboration. We'll hear different ideas and perspectives and experiences from the presenters, and we hope both that this is an opportunity for sharing ideas. It's an opportunity to hear about specific projects that your group could potentially take back with you and do, you know, right away. And then we really want to go to that next level of, is there something that as a group we can do better than we can alone? So we'll just start with introductions. And I'll start with Paul. Here we go. Okay, great.
My name is Paul Hunt, the environmental manager with the Portland Water District, and you'll hear plenty from me, so I'm gonna move on to the next.
Good evening, everyone. You'll hear from me too. I'm Kevin Ryan. I head up the Ecological Services Division of FB Environmental.
And I'm Chris Fort. I work here at UNE in the Department of Environmental Studies, and also at the Wells Reserve with the Coastal Training Program, and you'll hear more about that.
I'm Doreen Johnson. I work with the Collaborative with Jess, and we are so excited that you guys came all the way out here. It's a little bit different, a different topic, and we're excited about our summer associates, both Danny here, Connor, and Sophie, so thanks for coming.
My name is Emily Green. I'm with Rachel Carson National Wildlife Refuge, and we do a lot of habitat restoration and very little with water. So I'm here just as a guest, but also to kind of figure out what's going on in our community and maybe what we can do better for the environment on our end.
I'm Aaron O'Bonabacher. I'm associated with Oceanside Conservation Trust in the Iowa Tribe.
I'm Michael Parker from Presumpska Regional Land Trust.
Kathy Mills from Light Snacks, especially at this hour. Scarborough Land Trust.
And I'm Stephanie Smith from the Friends of Scarborough Marsh. So obviously, anything we can learn about watersheds and the impact of whatever's happening.
And Betsy Eric, also from Friends of Scarborough Marsh.
And I'm Sophie Scott. As Doreen mentioned, I'm the Summer Communication Associate for SMCC this summer.
I'm Maggie Burns, and I work with Kevin at FB Environmental. So.
Connor Montello, I'm another associate for SMCC as the GIS associate, and I also work with Portland Trails.
So it's great. We have a nice, cozy group, and behind us, each of us carries a whole another group with representation of, oh, that behind us too, yes.
I'm Pat Redd, I'm representing the cheerleading wife group. Paul Hunt is my husband.
Welcome. So I brought my mother with me, so if you don't like my talk, you have to pretend that you do.
Great, so without further ado, take it away, Paul.
It's odd to be holding a microphone. I feel like Bob Barker. Wait, only half of us will know who I'm talking about, the rest of you. Thank you all very much for the opportunity to talk today. I'm Paul Hunt, the environmental manager with the Portland Water District. So it might seem odd to have someone from the water district speaking to a land group, but I will tell you that I've been in the water protection business for over 20 years, and it took me about half that time to come to realize that water protection is really all about land conservation. So that's what I'm going to talk about. And the title of my talk is Trees Not Treatment, and I just want to recognize my colleague Laurel Jackson, who works in my office and manages the program I'm going to be talking about. So my boss always says, start a letter with what you're going to say and then repeat it, and you know, and then explain it and then repeat it. So I'm going to start with the end and say that the Portland Water District has a land conservation program that applies to the Sebago Lake watershed. And the program kind of works this way. When a landowner, like this one, decides he or she wants to conserve their land, either by easement or fee, and has found a land trust to do that transaction with, they make that decision first. The water district is not involved in that part of the process. But then the next step is that the land trust brings that proposal to us and says, hey, we have an opportunity here to conserve this property. Is the water district interested? And we evaluate the property for the degree to which we think it benefits drinking water quality and come up with kind of a number. The staff comes up with a number, a recommended contribution, and then our board of trustees votes on that, on whether or not to make that contribution. In the past 10 years, we have been involved in land transactions by the land trust in the watershed, totaling about almost $4.5 million in value, the value of all the transactions, and the district has paid about $500,000 toward that amount.
How many transactions?
That is such a good question. The answer to your question is, you can see this graph starts at 2008 and until 2015. The height of the bar is how many acres went under easement or were conserved in fee or purchased in fee, and the number in the box is how many transactions that amounts to. So I think it's about 16 or so that have occurred. You can add them up. But it's about 4,000 acres of land altogether. This is how my talk is organized. You'll notice I'm going fast because I'm trying to stay on time. First, I'll tell you about my company and Sebago Lake a little bit. Then I'll tell you about the program and how it came to be. I'll talk about the process by which we evaluate land to determine what the district's level of contribution should be, and then I'll try to answer any questions if there's time. I've been working for the Portland Water District on about 17 years. My favorite, and I'm not just saying this because I still work there, the best company I've ever worked for. I've worked public and private, and this is my favorite because it's sort of a combination. It's a nonprofit, but it produces a product, and so it's kind of like the best of both worlds. We've been providing drinking water to Greater Portland since 1908. We're also Maine's largest wastewater utility, but I'm not going to talk about that half of the business. The program I'm going to talk about is on the water side of our business. Here's Sebago Lake from the air. It's enormous. If you haven't been there, it's a 30,000-acre lake. And it averages 100 feet over that entire area. So if you do the math, you know, area, 30,000 acres, 100 feet, you can convert that to volume and then convert that to gallons, and you get almost a trillion gallons of water, which is kind of a stunning number. You know, it almost, I used to think a trillion was like infinity until the great financial catastrophe of 2008, and then you realize it is actually a finite amount. But we use about 8 billion gallons in a year to serve all of Greater Portland. So that means we have over 100 years in storage, which is an enviable position. Imagine if you're in California, how much you'd give for 100 years worth of water in storage. I'll also tell you that the water from Sebago Lake is so clean that we are one of only 50 out of about 13,000 utilities in the United States that are not required to filter the water before we disinfect it and send it to our customers. The water comes out of the lake,
it's disinfected, and then you are drinking it. And only 50 utilities in the country qualify for that exemption. Here's the watershed. It's about 10 times as big as the lake, or 280,000 acres. There are about more than 20 towns. Some of them just have a little tiny piece, but there's 20 towns that make up the watershed. These last two bullets should be reversed. It's largely forested. That's the good news. But it's more than 90% privately owned forest, so it could be converted if the landowners choose to. They want to make it into a subdivision, they can. And so that's really our big challenge. And like I say, it took me probably 10 years of working there before I realized that's a key challenge for the long-term health of Sebago Lake, is that 91.5% privately owned forest that makes up the watershed. Just to give you a sense of how fortunate we are, if you notice, the Sebago Lake watershed, when you're a kid, you learn that a watershed is like a bowl, and the bowl and the lake sits in the bottom of the bowl. Notice that the Sebago Lake watershed is not shaped like a bowl. It's long and skinny, and almost all of the watershed is north and west of the lake. None of it is south and east of the lake. Well, south and east of the lake is Greater Portland, and so if that were in the watershed, all that runoff would flow into the lake. It wouldn't be as clean. This is what the watershed kind of typically looks like. This is the Naples Causeway. All I want you to see from that picture is green and furry. It's really very forested, and that's what is treating the water. That's why the water is so clean. The district has been protecting Sebago Lake, as I say, for over 100 years, and our watershed control program, which is a legal requirement of a public water utility, has these three, for 100 years, has had three major components, and they're represented by those three pictures. Inspecting projects, particularly in the shoreland zone of the lake, when a house is being built or a septic system is being put in, we're there to inspect it and make sure no soil is flowing into the lake. Just to give you a sense of how often we do that, this map just shows you each of those dots is an inspection we've done. We do about 5,000 of them in a 500 in a year, so over a 10-year period, about 5,000. And you can just see we kind of ring the lake. We go, and if there's a project going on, we just want to make sure it's being done properly. Inspection. The middle picture represents education and outreach. We communicate with children and adults about what we're trying to do, what threatens the lake, so that they'll help us to protect it. And then the last thing we do is we patrol by boat the southern part of the lake, which is where our intakes are, where the water is being drawn from, to make sure no one's swimming and the rules are being followed. So inspection, education, outreach, and security, that's been our program really for 100 years. It's only in the last 10 that we've kind of come to realize that even if the shoreland zone is very healthy because all the construction projects are being done well, if the land behind the shoreland zone gets converted from forest to parking lot, the water quality in the lake is not going to be as high as it is now. And that's when we really started looking up watershed and saying, what can we do about that particular issue? And we had worked with the land trust a little bit, kind of on an ad hoc basis. They would come to us and say, hey, there's a project we're working on. It's in the Sebago Lake watershed. Would you help us pay for it? And we'd say, I don't know. You know, I really had no, there was no program. And I went to the board and said, could we give like a few $1,000 to help with this transaction? And the board said, sounds like a good idea. You know, that's really the essence of it. There was no program, no policy about what do we do when land is being conserved in the watershed. So in 2007, our board adopted a policy, which essentially said, we're not going to buy all the land in the watershed. That's not feasible or desirable. We don't want to own all the land in the watershed, but we support efforts of others to conserve land in perpetuity in its forested state. You might say, so big deal. You know, there's no money involved. It didn't say how much we would contribute. It didn't say anything about contribution. It just said we believe in it. But when you work for a nonprofit, policy is really an important, it's like a statement of principles, and that's sort of where it begins. And once you have a statement of principles that the board has voted on and said, yes, we believe in that, then you can start thinking about, well, should we have a program to implement that policy? So that's what happened next, is and we made some contributions after 2007 to some land conservation deals, but it was in 2013 that we created a program, which is the program I was talking about. When we set out to do this with two goals. One was to have a consistent methodology, because as I said, land trust would come to us and say, we're doing this deal, can you help us? And we would say, okay, how much? And they'd say, how about $10,000? And we'd say, okay, we'll bring it to the board. And we really had no methodology to say, how much is it really worth? And then the second thing was, we loved that land was being conserved in the watershed, but we said to the land trust, can you go a little faster? I mean, you conserved 100 acres this year, but there's 300,000 of them out there. Could you do more? And they said, if there was more money, we could do more. So that was when our board sort of deliberated on that and established a land conservation program, which is, again, has money attached to it. It was really all about putting money into this policy, behind this policy that we believe in conservation. And the policy is several pages long, or the program, but really just remember this one number. The program says the district will contribute up to 25% of the transaction value, which, you, as you know, if you're in the land trust business, a transaction can be worth $1 million. So 25%, now we're talking about a much larger contribution on the part of the district. So how does it work? Well, first thing we did is we said, well, not all transactions in the watershed are worth the same as others, because again, our goal is water quality. A land conservation deal could have other goals, wildlife goals, aesthetic goals, but ours is, you know, our customers are, we're focused on water quality because that's what they pay us to do. So we took the watershed and we zoned it into three zones. It's hard to see on this map, so I'll zoom in a little bit more and show you. Essentially, all it says is the closer you are to water, the more we value this transaction, because the more it does for water quality. So you can see there's like buffers around all the streams of, I think, 1,000 feet. That's zone one, a land transaction in there. We value the highest. Zone two is in green, and then brown is zone three. That's like the top of the ridges. So that's further away from water. We still will contribute to a land deal there, but it just doesn't have the same value to us as one right on the water. So we zoned the watershed that way. And then once a landowner and land trust agree on a transaction, then they come to us and say, will you contribute to this? And so what we do is we evaluate the property. It's a four-page report. I won't go through it all in detail except the last two pages, because that's kind of where all the action is. This is where we come up with a number. So in this particular example, first thing we do is look at how many acres it is and how much of it is in zone one and zone two and zone three. And so you can see this property shown in this outline in red is mostly in zones one and two. Forest cover is the next thing we look at, because land that's covered in trees is going to do more for water quality than land where the trees are gone. So we value that a little bit higher and we add 2%. So we come up with an amount here and then we add 2% for all these other factors to come up with a percentage. The third thing we look at is it underlain by significant sand and gravel aquifers? If it is, then, you know, again, water is going to be moving through that land and sort of naturally being cleaned. So that's more valuable to us. And then are there wetlands on the property? Because again, wetlands are doing a lot of water treatment. So if there's wetlands, then we value that higher and add another 2%. This last page has a lot of numbers on it, but don't worry about them, because I'll just highlight the ones you want to know. We start by what is the overall value of this transaction, if it's in fee or an easement. What is this? What's the value of it? Is it an appraised value? We also do a calculation and we pick the lower of the two in case the land trust is paying a lot more than we think it would be worth, which sometimes happens. Other times it's the other way around. But we come up with an overall value, and then if it's in zone one, we start at 15%. So if no other factors are in play, but it's in zone one, our recommendation to our board would be we should contribute 15%. And then we just look at each of those factors that I told you about. One I didn't mention is if it's in one of the seven towns right around the lake, we add 2% because it's very close to Sebago Lake. The next thing we do is we say, is it more than 50% forested? If yes, we add 2% more, but in this case it wasn't. Then we ask, is more than 10% of the land underlain by sand and gravel aquifer? If yes, we add another 2%. Is it more than 20% wetland? That's worth 2%. And then there's this other category. Is there anything else that isn't covered by all that we think is important? If so, then staff can recommend another 2%. And so then you do the math and you say, okay, it's 160,000 times 21%. So staff would recommend to the board a contribution in this case of $33,600, which is what we did recommend. And then the board votes on it and they can say no, they can say yes, they can change the board is independent and does, you know, they run the company, but staff makes a recommendation and then the board votes. And I will say that since we started this, the board has voted 11-0 every single time to accept the staff's recommendation. So they like what we came up with. So this is kind of the end result, is this is showing you the Sebago Lake watershed outline. There's a little land in green. That's all the district owns. We own less than 1%, and some of it's even out of the watershed, but that's the land that we own right by our water intakes. The rest that you see in gray is land that is protected or conserved. Either Sebago Lake State Park is part of that, White Mountain National Forest you can see there, and then the smaller ones are land trust parcels that are either owned in fee or in easement by the land trust. So that's what we started with, and now what I'm going to add is these are all the properties that have been conserved with district support in the past 10 years or so, the ones shown in pink. So you can see that it's starting to add up to a significant increase in the total amount of conserved land. Okay, so the last thing I'm going to talk about is this one water idea, the sort of the theme of tonight. And in the water business, what one water has come to mean, and you hear that phrase in my business a lot, is that historically, you know, water management involves lots of different things. There's stormwater management, there's wastewater treatment, there's irrigation for agriculture. There's a lot of ways that humans are engineering the environment to manage water issues. And historically, they've been done independent of one another. There's a water department that found a source of water, treated it, and provided it to customers, and then a different department, maybe even another whole organization responsible for collecting that and sewering it to a treatment plant and treating it, another department working on stormwater. These things were all done in isolation. And more, and our company is really an example of this, we're a combined water and wastewater utility, so we approach questions and engineering solutions to water issues with water and wastewater in mind, and we also partner with the cities that we serve on stormwater management. And so we're kind of looking more holistically at the issue of water, because it's the same drop of water that is first being consumed and then being flushed and then being, you know, it's the same drop of water. And so solutions that kind of take all that into account can often be more cost effective. So that's sort of the one water idea. So for you, I would say, as I thought about my talk tonight, I would say there's something I would call the one forest idea, and that is that often land conservation, or there are organizations out there that want to see land conserved for lots of different reasons. For jobs, you know, for forest jobs, working forest, wood products that come from those jobs, conserve wildlife habitat, outdoor recreation, all of these things. And I guess the idea I would promote is that, you know, rather than having eight different goals and eight different organizations looking for eight different properties to conserve to meet their eight goals, if everyone could get together and contribute $1 a piece, then you'd have $8 and you can maybe purchase one piece of property that does all of those things, or many of them. So meeting many goals with one transaction, which is again kind of the one water idea, is solving many water problems with one solution. I think that's my last slide, so I don't know how I did, but I'm happy to answer any questions.
Very well. Nice job. Have any quick clarifying questions for Paul? Again, we'll have time afterwards to get into the meat.
Do you know what land trusts are in your? Are there too many to mention?
Well, there are two. The two that make up the bulk of it are Western Foothills Land Trust and Luneco Land Trust. And then there are three others that have little tiny pieces. We have done transactions with two of them, by the way. So if it's in the watershed, and we've done a transaction with SWOM, and we've done a transaction with a Boys and Girls Camp that didn't involve a land trust. So essentially anybody that wants to conserve land in perpetuity in the watershed is eligible.
This is perhaps nitpicking, but maybe an opening to a good conversation. You put lawn irrigation in as a separate item. Is that because you were thinking about Portland as a metropolitan area? It seems like peripheral.
That was me about 2 days ago saying, what are all the things that people do, what are important things that people find important to use water for? So I, you know, there are certainly in other states it's a bigger deal to have water from watering your lawn.
I grew up in California.
Right. So that there are periods of time where you can't water your lawn. We don't really face that very often in Maine.
Reusing water is an issue.
Right, which is a one water kind of solution, is thinking more holistically about the use of water and what's the most cost-effective way to meet our needs.
Or reusing water that's treated.
Right, which happens in many states. Doesn't happen in Maine yet, but I'm sure, well, we're a water-rich state.
California, but they pump it into the ground so people don't really realize it came out of the sewage plant.
I know that that's true.
And how many communities depend on this water source?
11. 200,000 people altogether, and really all of us do, because if you've ever been treated in a medical center, if you've ever gone to eat in Portland, if you, you know, there's our water system is serving a lot of, a large percentage of Maine's population, at least intermittently.
Great.
Okay, thanks.
Paul. Yeah, and Kevin and Maggie are going to speak next, but before you do, we had some folks come in while Paul was speaking, so I just wanted to give the four of you a chance to introduce yourselves, your name, and your organization. Anyone can start. Rochelle, why don't you start?
I'm Rochelle from the Prism Scott Regional Land Trust.
I'm Jean Noon from Three Rivers Land Trust.
I'm Helen Naylor from Three Rivers Land Trust also. Sorry we're late. A lot of traffic.
Same traffic, Bryce Hawk with Maine Audubon.
So we now have 11 groups in the room. Yeah, not counting our presenters. So now Paul and Maggie.
Well, hello again, everybody. Thanks for coming tonight. Again, I'm Kevin Ryan. I'm here with Maggie Burns from FB Environmental.
Sorry.
What's that?
Paul.
It's okay. I let it go. So FB Environmental, we have two, we're truly a small business. We have 9 people spread over 2 offices. Our headquarters is here in Maine, in Portland, and we have another office in Portsmouth, New Hampshire. It was started by our boss, Forrest Bell, in 2001. He was hired to do some lake assessment projects, as I understand, in Maine. And the business just kind of grew from there. He just kept getting work, needed to hire employees, and now, this many years later, he's got FB Environmental. And if he was here, he'd say it's what we do is basically where science meets civics. We take the best available scientific information that's known currently and apply it to conservation projects to produce tangible, on-the-ground conservation results. So most of our work is done in the public sector. We work a lot for a lot of municipalities, mostly in Maine and New Hampshire, but we do work throughout New England, but of course it's concentrated around our offices. And we work for a lot of watershed organizations and lake organizations as well. We've worked for a number of land trusts. We have a partnership with SMCC where we've done a bunch of different types of work for land trusts, anything from easement monitoring to baseline documentation, natural resources inventories, just about anything a land trust could need help with. We work with state and federal governments, and we do some private work as well. We don't avoid the private clients, it just so happens that way. I've helped out recently with several clean energy projects involving either solar power or sometimes wind power. And occasionally a private landowner will ask you to do a natural resources inventory on their land or something like that. So our work spans the realms of environmental science and ecology. Just to clarify, environmental science being the physical parameters of the environment, things like dissolved oxygen and salinity of your water, everything like that, and ecology being organisms and the relationship to one another and to their environment. So a lot of what we do is water quality monitoring and water quality fixing. That's sort of what we're known for. To borrow from something I heard Fred Dillon of South Portland say, you've heard of non-point source pollution as sort of like death by 1,000 cuts. Well, a lot of what we do is sort of healing by 1,000 Band-Aids. Just have a lot of small projects all over, just fixing. We do watershed scale things, but then we have a lot of projects too that are just fixing little issues here and there. And so we're here today just to give an overview of some of the projects that we do that are specific to water quality. We're going to talk about what we've got going on with the Wyndham Land Trust, and I'm going to turn it over to Maggie in a minute, where we're monitoring 2 brooks and a small body of water for them. We work with the Keyser Lake Watershed Association. We've been monitoring water quality in Keyser Lake for a long time, and they've recently started up a climate change observatory. And lastly, I'm going to talk about a project that we've done a few years ago with the Chebegan Cumberland Land Trust, which where we don't have our hands in the water, but nevertheless, as Paul was mentioning, what you do with the land has an effect on the water, so it has to do with the land acquisition project there. But what we want to get across, too, is that as we are a business, we're a consulting firm. People do hire us to go out, do this, produce a report, give us the results. But since we're a small firm, we also have the flexibility to start up partnerships with other organizations. And so sometimes we may handle one aspect of a project and we're actually in the field with members of the other organizations, some of which Maggie is going to talk about. So with that, I'll turn it over to her.
Okay, so as Kevin was saying, one of the most important things we want to highlight with our projects today is groups where the volunteers are really on the ground participating in the effort, and we're working with them kind of as a unit to look at land and look at water and think about how we can move forward in the best way. And so we wanted to talk about the Windham Land Trust, and we work with Windham looking at two of the streams that they have, Otter Brook and Black Brook. And one of the most interesting parts of working with Windham is that they're this small group of really gung-ho, awesome volunteers who do a lot of the on-the-ground work themselves. And just to note that all of these small efforts have a big impact. So these streams go into the Presumpscot River, which goes to Casco Bay. So we all are all affected by the small little projects that are going on, and they're all really important. And so what goes on in Windham? And so the first step is the data collection. So the Land Trust volunteers do all of the data collection. And so we are there to facilitate them through the process, to make sure the protocols and the methodologies are right, that the communication with the lab is right. But they do all of the sampling. And so after, at the end of the season, they give us the data. Well, we have the data as the season progresses. We take the data, we process it, and we provide them with a small report that explains what their data is showing and how we can use that data moving forward to make recommendations. So what exactly are they doing in Windham? So one of the things that they're doing is monthly E. coli samples. And so they go out and they take grab samples in their streams at designated locations. And they also do dissolved oxygen monitoring with a handheld meter. And so overall, they've seen some issues with bacteria over the years. And so they're really working hard to identify and isolate those sources and doing that on making a big effort on their own for that. So just to highlight a few different projects that have gone on in Windham in both related to the water and to the land. They've done some trail building at one of their Black Brook Preserve. And so they've really been working to make their preserves accessible to the public and provide some education on conservation and why it's important. They've also done some planting at Otter Brook. And so planting along the riparian areas is good for shading, it's good for filtration. So they've focused on putting in some more vegetation, trying to protect these headwater streams. And the last thing they've done is they have a parcel Frog Hollow Farm, which on it contains Frog Hollow Pond. And then you can see in the bottom left that it is pretty turbid. And so last summer we did a small evaluation for them, and they're working on trying to improve the water quality of this pond for both the biological life in the pond and also for the aesthetic pleasure of people enjoying their parcel. So the other project we wanted to touch on that is really a unique and exciting project that brings together the land and the water and really just a whole watershed approach is at Keyser Lake and with the Keyser Lake Watershed Association. So if you've never been there, it's absolutely beautiful. And it's located, you can see in this map on the left, it's located in western Maine in Lovell. And it actually, you can see in this blow up on the right, I don't know if you can see that green part in the top, but it borders and it has a little bit of the White Mountain National Forest in its headwaters. So that's pretty unique to have that in your watershed. And so within the Keyser Lake watershed, Keyser Lake is in the center and there's three distinct basins. And so we help the Watershed Association with sampling in each of those basins and taking a whole watershed approach. We also work with them on sampling six of the ponds in the watershed. So additionally, in terms of monitoring, they've been monitoring for many years now. And so in the image on the right, you can see this is Heinrich Wurm, and he's one of the Watershed Association volunteers and does a lot of the groundwork for the water quality of Keyser Lake. And so that's a picture of him on a sampling day. So they come out with us and we do it together. And then these images here, you can see we have some continuous data loggers, and we've deployed these in many streams around the lake. And so these are taking data every 15 minutes. I just put an example here of a graph showing temperature over a season so that you can really see the fluctuations. And one of the reasons that we're interested in this is that there are different land use projects going on within the watershed. And so understanding the tributaries and how all of the different tributaries are contributing to the greater lake is really important. And seeing that change based on land use decisions over time is really valuable. So they've done years of monitoring here, and monitoring is really important and exciting. But they are also, one of the unique parts of this project is that they are seeing forward. And so we all probably recognize that climate change is happening in Maine. This is something that we're dealing with and we're facing. And we're seeing, you know, not just warming temperatures, but changes in precipitation. And so the Keyser Lake Watershed Association really came together and they thought, you know, how are we going to protect the water at Keyser Lake? And the water quality of Keyser Lake is fabulous. They are really lucky. They have great water quality. And so they wanted to move forward and think, how can we protect this? So they formed a bunch of different partnerships and brought everybody together, and they formed the Climate Change Observatory. And each of these parts plays a unique role, but there are water organizations, there are land organizations, there are universities. And so it's a really cool program, and what they're doing is they're focusing on looking forward at Keyser and thinking, okay, moving forward, how can we protect our waters? So this is just a snapshot from the 2015 report that we put together for them. And so you can see in the bottom here, this is the key. And so the color is representing the condition, and the arrow is representing the trend. And so they're using this rich historical set of data to identify within each of the basins and the ponds, not only, you know, what does it look like today, but how is this data trending? And so this example here is for water clarity. So you can see time in years on the x-axis and meters below the surface on the y. So the deeper the point, the clearer the water. And so for all three basins in this case, Keyser has excellent water clarity and it is increasing. So another thing they're doing to think about climate change in their watershed is to assess the infrastructure that they have. And so last summer, we worked with them on a culvert survey where we went through the watershed and we looked at all of the culverts and we tried to figure out if the infrastructure was capable of supporting a change in climate and in some cases, if it was capable of handling the current climate. And so if we see increases in precipitation, then can these culverts handle more water coming down in shorter periods of time? Or ecologically, if we need to have better connectivity of tributaries up the watershed for cold water fish to maybe move with warmer waters, is that possibility there for them? So this is just one example I wanted to pull out to show how Keyser is really looking at the whole watershed, and they're thinking about how everything is connected, and it's really important and it's really exciting, and I'm excited to see how they move forward with it. So with that, I will turn it back over to Kevin, who will talk about Broad Cove.
So for this project, we didn't necessarily have our hands in the water, but as we know, any land acquisition project is going to have an effect on water quality. And with this project, we worked with the Town of Cumberland and the Chebegan Cumberland Land Trust. Some of you may be familiar. I see Kathy's nodding her head with newspaper articles and whatnot on this. This is a 103-acre parcel that was known as the Payson property. owned by the Payson family, and the Sheboygan Cumberland Land Trust has had an easement on there since the 1990s, which actually allows for subdivision of the property. So what happened is this: those lots are going to become housing lots, but the developer took one parcel here that's sort of outlined like that and sold it to the town. Now, if I remember the numbers correctly, Cumberland had 6 miles of coastline and about 200 feet of coast access. So this was a pretty exciting project for the town, where they're finally going to have a nice town beach to be on. But of course, they'd like to do the right thing by the environment and keep things the way they are. That's also mentioned in the easement that it needs to be. They have to maintain water quality and whatnot. So they hired us to conduct a natural resources inventory of the entire property and then makes recommendations specific to the Broad Cove Reserve when they allow public access there. So it's, as far as marine habitats go, the place was pretty rich. There's a nice coastline there. There's both high marsh grass, low marsh grass, American beach grass that's interspersed with the seaside goldenrod. It's really quite pretty. The northern end of the beach there has a pretty extensive clam flat. There's eelgrass beds just offshore. And the DMR has mapped habitats just offshore. There's marine worms. The whole area is mapped for marine worms. There's soft and hard shell clams, razor clams, surf clams, blue mussels, and also horseshoe crabs come up and nest on the beach. And I believe that the CCLT has educational events every May and June out there, which is pretty well attended for the horseshoe crabs. One thing that's not on the beach that makes it good for people to access is there's no nesting birds because the tide comes up too high. At high tide, there's no beach left, so any nests would get washed out. So there's no shortage of natural resources on the property, but it's not without its issues. Casco Bay is negatively impacted by stormwater runoff, and there's a well-known relationship, positive correlation between increasing impervious surface and decreasing water quality. And I think the town has already 10 to 15% about that impervious area in the vicinity of this property, which you already start to see effects on water quality just at that level. And the Department of Marine Resources has also documented water quality issues at Broad Cove, and that some of the tributaries going into it contain fecal coliform levels that are higher than what is acceptable. So to help protect some of these natural areas, we recommend that they put protective fencing around natural areas, around the grass areas, to minimize foot traffic and to not rip up the vegetation. And we're also going to direct wading and swimming and boating away from the eelgrass beds. So that'll be where boat moorings are going to be very carefully placed, and there's actually a special type of mooring that you can use within the eelgrass to keep that from getting ripped up. And also limit of cutting trees for aesthetic purposes. All those housing lots have view sheds that go down. We're trying to encourage not to cut too much of the trees, of course, because the tree canopy and the trees themselves are catching and slowing down water that's entering into the bay. Another thing, full disclosure, I'm a dog owner. I let my dog run on the beach where it's allowed and whatnot. This has not been a well-established dog walking area, so we recommended that no dogs be on this beach. It might have been a different story if this was people had been going for 20 years, but in this case, it's not, so just don't allow it off from the beginning because they're not going to catch all the dog waste that goes, which can actually lead to serious issues in the clam flats. The next issue is parking. Naturally, you would want to have parking close to the beach, but that's anything dripping that's impervious surface and anything coming off the car is going to go right into the water. So as such, we actually recommended, and they went forward with it, that they're going to put the parking lot right up along Route 88 and just have some handicapped spots and a turnaround down. So people are going to have to walk down to get to the water. The parking lot is situated way far away from the beach. And there's also low impact development practices that they can use using permeable surfaces. So instead of using concrete and things like that, you use other types, pavers or other types of surfaces where water can infiltrate to try to keep the level of runoff after the park is built the same as it was before. So, and with that, we take any questions. Any clarifying questions that people may have? That's our field assistant, and Laura Deemer, that's the head of our water quality monitoring division.
He's not one of the sniffing.
He'll sniff anything, but he won't tell you what it is. We do work with sewage sniffing dogs, too. I didn't mention that in this talk. But yeah.
That beach area doesn't have any nesting possibility because the water comes up already.
Where's the water line going to be when the little increase in sea level?
Higher. You don't. There's a there's a very, very, very steep drop. It's almost, I mean, I'll hike anywhere, and the drop is so steep down to the beach that it's actually hard to walk. So the public really won't be able to use that beach at high tide because there's going to be nowhere to go. But it's going to take a lot of sea level rise for it to come up and invade any of the property. There's quite a steep bank there.
The teaser project, I find all of this really thrilling. What can I say? That people are collecting this kind of information, communities are supporting the collection of this kind of information, and that it has real impact on the ground. The Keyser project is not small, and how is that being funded? I mean, I see the collaborative work that was being done as sort of stage two, but early on, who put up the funds to enlist you folks to begin doing some pretty comprehensive work? Was it Land
Trust? They've got some pretty good grants that they've gotten, and they also had some capital campaign money.
The Keyser Lake Watershed Association made it rain, as I understand. When it comes to that, I'm not intimately familiar with how they funded it, but I do know, and I can find out if you'd like more information.
So that's it's a watershed association. It's separate from a land trust, affiliated, I'm guessing.
Yes. Yeah, the Greater Lowell Land Trust is separate.
Okay, gotcha.
So the Watershed Association is the primary funders that work with.
Great. Thanks.
Thank you.
Well, I always love coming to events like this and holding microphones. It's one of my favorite things to do because I hear so many good stories, and that's a theme in the work that I do around water, is sharing these stories about all the good work that everybody's doing. I guess that's the only button I really need to see, is that one right there. So, and we've heard this term today in the talks about headwaters to the sea. And one thing I pay attention a lot to is language. And in the case of all the work that you all do with land trusts and the work you've heard about today, I pretty much think we're all in the same boat. We're all trying to protect things that we care about. Land and water are linked like that. When you protect land, you protect water. But we also face the same challenges, the same frustrations. And as much as I love hearing the stories of hope, I spend a lot of time hearing stories of frustration as well. And one of the goals of my work is, how can I help people deal with those stories of frustration so they can kind of get to that reason for hope that they're working on? So, just like Paul said, I'm going to tell you what I'm going to tell you, then I'm going to tell you, and then I'm going to tell you what I told you, because that's what my boss told me to do, those three things. So, my talk about watershed collaborations is going to link them to how we actually create landscapes of hope, kind of a metaphorical landscape where when people look out, they have hope for the future rather than things are always getting worse. So thinking of things always getting better. So I'm going to do, my field is social science. So the first thing I'm going to mention and talk to you about is, are your mental models of the work that you do limiting your ability to create landscapes of hope? And I'm going to talk about some of my mental models that have been changed as a result of my research. And then I'm going to tell you about four projects that I was involved with lots of partners. And Jean, I have to say, I used to have Sanford in this story, but when I heard I only had 15 minutes, if I had known you were going to be here, Sanford would have stayed and the Salmon Falls would have been out. When I saw Jean walk in, I went, oh, I took Sanford out. Because the last time I told the story, the Sanford Conservation Plan was in it. So the three stories are the Protecting Our Children's Water story, the Salmon Falls Watershed Collaborative story, the Sustaining the Saco Estuary story, right next door, and then this little question of how do people value riparian buffers? Again, focusing a little bit more on a social science lens than a biology lens. So a little bit about mental models. Mental models are just, they're structures in your brain that you use to organize information, you kind of have a model of how things work. You have a model of what it's like to come to a talk and listen to a PowerPoint, and you kind of know what that's going to be like. You have mental models of what it's like to go to a restaurant and order dinner. And they make life easier, it makes communication easier, but the problem, as Mark Twain identified a long time ago, it ain't what you don't know that gets you into trouble, it's what you know for sure that just ain't so. And that's how mental models can get you into trouble. If you have a mental model of how something works, or a mental model of how someone else thinks, oh, I know them, they don't care. I know them, they don't know. And you go from that mental model of saying, well, it's no use talking to them, they don't care. Or let's give them more information, because the reason they're not doing what we want is they don't have the information. And sometimes those mental models cause us to spend a lot of effort and a lot of time doing things that don't get us where we want to go. So I've been studying mental models around water and water protection because I thought, you know, sometimes it's frustrating. So the first time I started to study these mental models, I had a background in ecology. So my bachelor's degree is in zoology, my master's is in coastal ecology, and when I started my PhD program, I said, you know what, I know a lot about watersheds, water chemistry. It's not the problem all the time. Sometimes the problem is the people. So as much as I want to just spend my time in the middle of a salt marsh measuring marsh grass, I'm going to have to study people. So the project that I did for my PhD dissertation was called Protecting Our Children's Water. And I actually heard somebody using that similar phrase during their presentation. So I conducted interviews of Southern Maine water managers. So the cities that I studied were Biddeford, Wells, and Kennebunk. And that's where I interviewed people. And I just asked the people I interviewed three simple questions. I said, why is water important? What do you think are the things that are threatening water? And what do you think can be done to protect water? And the answers I got from that completely switched my mental models about how I could do a better job protecting water. Because when I went into the project, I said, well, or people told me, well, it's no use working with municipal officials. They don't really care about water. They're running the town. They want to save money. They don't care that much about water. The main thing you've got to do is educate them about water quality. But after I talked to people, I found out there's six major ways that these people I interviewed think about water. And this is how people in Southern Maine, how they told me they valued water. One thing they told me, water is the basis for all life. They understood it that way. They thought everything from the smallest cell to the planet and meteorology depends on water. So water is life. And that came out in their interviews. They also said that nature makes water. Almost everybody understood that watersheds and forested watersheds are the source of drinking water. They also said that water is a landscape feature, and we could probably do an assessment of property values and find out that property next to water has a higher value, and that's just having water in your backyard. And this one is, water is a commodity. Water is something that can be bottled and sold as a resource. Water is also something we manage through dams and other ways, irrigation. And then the last model of water was, water is actually waste, and we depend on water to take away the waste of society. And from analyzing all the data, those were the six main things that came up about different ways that people value water. But the thing that I was most surprised about when I talked to these Southern Maine folks was their answer to how can we protect water. And in talking to everyone, they came up with eight ways in Southern Maine that water is protected. And I have talked to people all over the country and two other countries, Canada and Mexico, which aren't that far away. And I've asked people after I tell them about this kaleidoscope of expertise, and so far nobody has ever given me a different category from the eight that Southern Maine talked about. So I know it's a little bit small print, but one way that water gets protected is we have regulations and we enforce the regulations. A second way that water gets protected is we have land use management and planning. We have different ways that land can be used. A third way is through the actions of public works, engineering, and wastewater. Their actions protect water. Then the whole idea of stewardship, not just citizens. This was the only category that someone added on. I always had citizen stewardship. They said, you're forgetting businesses and how businesses take care of water. Then people take care of water through education and outreach. And then the science was right here. Now, in my work at the Wells National Estuarine Research Reserve, we're really heavy on the science. And the science, that's kind of our job at the Wells Reserve. But if you look at the whole kaleidoscope of expertise, science is just one part of protecting water. Then this came out as a separate function, that people protecting the source of drinking water was a category. And last but not least, by far, most people I talk to realize the role of land conservation in water. And the reason I call this the kaleidoscope of expertise is depending on what kind of work you do, like we have land trust people here tonight, when you look at a water landscape or a watershed, you have kind of a glass that you're looking through, like a little kaleidoscope, that when you turn it, it looks different no matter how you turn it. So a land trust looks at water through a certain lens. A public works director still looks at water, still has the same values, but they have a little bit different lens. So if you think of a kaleidoscope that changes what you see, you put it all together knowing that everybody's concerned about the value of water. So let me ask you a question. When I say the word watershed, what kind of words pop into your head as far as watershed? What pops into your head? Just a single word.
Water.
Water itself, okay.
Slopes.
Land. What?
Slopes.
Slopes.
Drainage.
Drainage.
Filtration.
Filtration.
Conservation unit.
That's two words. That's where I was trying to add extra words. Conservation unit.
Habitat.
Habitat.
Pollution.
One more.
Catchment.
What?
Catchment.
Catchment, which is in Australia and Europe, a watershed's often called a catchment. So just that kind of thing that came to the top of your head, which is a little clue about mental models. This Southern Maine watersheds, a lot of my work is in this yellow watershed. And then this picture of a watershed, if you think of the land, the catchment, the slopes draining down to a watershed. Well, one thing that nobody talked about when you thought about a watershed was the human beings who are responsible for the condition of the watershed. Now, granted, the slope, the sediment, the native structure of the rocks determines water quality, but one of the most important things that determines the condition of a watershed is the social landscape that's at work in that watershed. So this is an entirely different mental model of thinking about a watershed. And at least for the work I do at the Wells Reserve and here, I focus primarily on the people in the landscape. And you've heard about how people in the landscape protect water. But those are the same eight categories in the kaleidoscope. And every group, for example, the land conservation group, you all are motivated and kind of your work is driven by best practices, the best way to identify land, prioritize it, fund it, and set it aside. And you're also driven by the values and ethics that drive your work. Well, you can say the same thing about engineering and public works. Those folks have best practices, and they also have ethics and best practices. So it's the combined effort of this kind of social landscape of a watershed that leads to the values and the condition of clean water. So in thinking about watershed work, it's just as important to think about the social side as it is the biological side. So the first story I'll tell you is about the Salmon Falls Watershed Collaborative. And the mental model for this project was a vision that was shared by the person in New Hampshire who is head of drinking water, and the person in Maine who were head of drinking water. And they were kind of challenged by, this Salmon Falls watershed, it's in two states, and we need to figure out a way for the two states to work together. But right now there's lots of barriers. So the idea came up for the Salmon Falls Watershed Collaborative for working across that barrier of New Hampshire and Maine. And I have to say, when I gave this talk in Mexico, they thought that was pretty funny, that we had a challenge dealing with Maine and New Hampshire, and this was the Tijuana watershed, where there's an estuarine research reserve where 90% of the watershed is in Tijuana, Mexico, and then the water comes across the state, the country line into Southern California. So they said, oh, that doesn't seem like a very big challenge. But it was perceived as a challenge. And you could think in your work, just sometimes it's a challenge to work across town borders. So there's all kinds of borders. So this is the blue outline is the Salmon Falls watershed. So Maine and New Hampshire, it's a tributary into the Piscataqua River. So then it drains into Great Bay. And since a lot of my work is with estuaries, that was the connection with the estuary. We started working together in 2009. We had a collaborative workshop with 80 people that showed up. We asked them what was important in the watershed, developed this action plan. And then we got an award from the American Water Works Association for the grassroots effort of bringing people together to create this action plan. Now, this is a kind of list that I'm sure you're all familiar with, but for somebody that deals with people, every project has its list of stakeholders. But what I find, no matter what the list is, these were the partners in the Salmon Falls Watershed Collaborative, but again, they all fit into the kaleidoscope. They all fit into one of the each categories for the kaleidoscope of expertise. That Beyond Borders workshop we had, it was just a one-day workshop, and we got people from Land Trust. It's the Moose Mountain Greenways Regional Land Trust and the Great Works Regional Land Trust are the two primary land trusts that are members of this group as far as land conservation. And we were also able to work with the Department of Agriculture with the funding sources they have, because this is a drinking water source. Somersworth and Berwick drink the Salmon Falls, so there is a lot of interest around protecting the land that produces the water. It's kind of a model about how the Salmon Falls watershed works, and that we use this collaborative process to kind of bring people together to protect the values we all care about and deal with the threats to water quality. We just had an event this summer called the Salmon Falls Success Safari, and we loaded people. Berwick donated a school bus, and we loaded people, and we started at the headwaters, the Acton-Wakefield Watershed Alliance, and we came all the way down to Berwick and finished up the tour with, do you know what a brownfield is? It's an old industrial site, hugely loaded with pollution, and Berwick has multiple brownfield grants from EPA. So we finished the tour eating ice cream in the ice cream shop, but looking at the brownfield site next to the river that's going to be cleaned up. The second story is right here in our backyard. You can look right out here and see the Saco Estuary. Biddeford and Saco in the distance. This is the Saco side, Biddeford on that side. And the mental model in this case was, if you think of coastal regions in Maine and estuaries, you might think, oh, Casco Bay, Penobscot Bay, Cobscook Bay, all the really wild, scenic places. And you wouldn't think so much about the Saco Estuary. If you're up north or down east, you might even look down on the little Saco Estuary and say, oh, what could be happening there? What's the mental model? The estuary is only 5 miles long, so starting right here next to campus and ending at Route 9 at the waterfalls in the middle of Biddeford and Saco. But through funding from NSF, we did a 5-year study. Another view, here's Biddeford Saco. You are sitting right there. And we spent 5 years looking at this particular estuary. It was a partnership with UNE and the Wells Reserve, and we studied both the people who care for the estuary and the plants and animals and marshes of the estuary. And we were pretty surprised. Again, we had our list of partners, and this was 20 of the partners that worked with us on the project. My particular job on the project was to find the partners and keep them engaged so they could help us with our research and help us understand how their work protected the estuary. And again, the same kaleidoscope of expertise. Matter of fact, when we were gathering the stakeholders, we used this. It's kind of like a one water approach, but it's more specific about who are the jobs that people are doing to protect water. And if you're trying to solve a hard problem, make sure you've got somebody from each category in the room. So So that's what we did here on the Saco. Three of the biggest pieces of the study were looking at the salt marsh. We have 5 miles of salt marsh. Pam Morgan is our salt marsh ecologist. And it's a classic, like, textbook gradient. So the salt marshes next to the mouth have full salinity, just like the ocean. And then the marshes up by the dams, it's zero. There's still tidal, but there's no salt. So it's a place where students can learn about that gradation. And they also found a couple of rare and endangered plants that we didn't even know were right on the estuary. So it's kind of a classic estuary. The other thing we looked at was birds, and again, in each case, it's a professor and student, so every summer, 9 undergraduate students would be involved in this, and we found 133 species of birds, and I'm just talking about the marsh right next to the river. They didn't go into the forest. All the sampling locations were standing in the marsh and looking or listening. So 133 species of birds using the estuarine, the water, and the marshes next to the Saco. 10% of the state's threatened birds use this 5 miles. 28% of species of special concern use this 5 miles. And in a way, what that might tell you as far as we studied the heck out of this little estuary, and you think, well, how many other small estuaries, things that might be in your land trust properties, have this same kind of biological diversity? It's just never been looked at in as much detail. And then our biggest story was about fish. This was combined research, both the Wells Reserve and UNE, and we sampled the salt marshes, because every day at high tide, fish species go up on the marsh and they eat invertebrates. It's a huge feeding and nursery for young fish. We looked at planktonic fish, we beach seine fish, and then we trawled for fish in the middle. So here was the data that it really drives people crazy when we talk to the other estuaries in the state. We found 60 species using the Saco at some stage of their life. Penobscot has only 22 species. Wells Harbor, 24, Casco Bay, 25, and Kennebec Point, 27. So the diversity of species using this little estuary is very, very high. And then we've continued the work on this project with our partners. I thought somebody from Biddeford might be here tonight, so yeah, but we'll tell. But Emily is here. Emily was in my water class last year. And one way we've continued to work in this watershed, despite the fact that the grant itself is over, is by incorporating the follow-up work in regular classes. So I teach a class called Sustaining Water, and Emily was in that class. And her class did a project with the Biddeford Conservation Commission to do education and outreach about their project on healthy lawns and also the Thatcher Brook watershed plan. So that way we can keep doing this kind of work with our partners. And this is kind of a different view. The other ones were looking up the estuary, but for this much of an urban area to be downstream, to be upstream of that estuary and still have the water quality be good enough to support the biodiversity is a kind of a testimony to the Clean Water Act and the work of Biddeford and Saco to clean up stormwater runoff from the town. And then the last story is a project we just finished at the Wells Reserve. We were looking at riparian buffers, and the idea about this came from a land trust meeting. Tin Smith, who works at the Wells Reserve and also works with the Great Works Regional Land Trust, had been doing work with land trusts for about a decade. And he said, you know what we need to do? We need to get all the land trust people in a room and ask them, what should we do for the next 10 years? So we had an evening workshop much like this and asked all the land trusts in Southern Maine to come and help us think about, we said, looking back. So we looked at where we'd come in the past 10 years. And then we said, what should we do for the next 10 years? And somebody spoke up from the Sanford group and said, we need to talk about economics. We need to talk about the money behind the choices. Why does it make economic sense to protect a buffer? Why does it make economic sense to protect land, to protect water? So we did a research project with Clark University on the economics of riparian buffers. I am not an economist. I mean, I'm an ecologist. I can hold my own with an ecologist. I can hold my own with some social scientists. But this was totally blew my mental models out of the park, understanding economics. Environmental economics is not always about money. And that was the hardest thing, because I know when the land trust asked us to study this, I know what they were expecting is we would get a money amount that said, if you protect this buffer, it will be worth X number of dollars compared to what you have to pay to filter water. But economics is about human well-being. It's about, are you better off with this than you are with this choice? And anything that makes humans better off has economic value, whether or not you can put a dollar on it, dollar value. So these were things you've all heard about tonight. The services provided by riparian buffers, they're called ecosystem services or natural services. So a buffer that's intact or a forest that's intact can filter pollution, it can protect us from erosion, it can protect us from flooding, provides wildlife habitat, drinking water, as well as recreation and beauty. And you can't always put numbers on that. Economists call those non-market values because they're not traded in the market. And this was what we looked at in this last study. So the watershed we looked at was the Maryland River Branch Brook watershed, which flows from Sanford. This is the headwaters in the town of Sanford. And it flows through Wells and Kennebunk and then empties into the ocean right at the Wells-Kennebunk line where Rachel Carson National Wildlife Refuge and the Wells Reserve is. So our question was, do people who aren't us value riparian buffers? Like, does the public value a riparian buffer, the services provided by a buffer? And I did bring some of these, if anyone wants to take a look at the end, but all of these resources are on the Wells Reserve website. I'll pass this survey around because my mental model, when we created this survey, Dr. Rob Johnston, who's an economist, he specializes in this kind of research. It's called a choice experiment. You spend part of the survey explaining what a buffer is, then you ask people to make a choice among different choices and ask, how much would you be willing to pay? Like, if your taxes were going to go up by $10 and you got a benefit of more brook trout or better stream quality, would you pay higher taxes? So I'll pass that around. It took a year to develop that survey, which is about 20 pages, because it's actually developed using focus groups. So if you ever, you think of focus groups like testing toothpaste or toys, 2 minutes? I'm almost near the end. So the focus group helped us write this in language that anybody could understand. And that survey was sent out to residents in Sanford, Wells, and Kennebunk. So three very different towns with different kinds of people to help us understand how people think about water. So first, the survey educates people about what riparian land does. And it was sent out in December of 2013. And I was sure no one would fill this out. First of all, it's Christmas. Second of all, the survey booklet is about 20 pages long. But we got a response rate of 35%. So of all the people, so we sent out 3,000 plus surveys. 1,000 were returned, these usable, statistically usable, 35%. And it was a random sample in Kennebunk, Sanford, and Wells. And everyone who lived in the watershed got a survey, and then the other parts of the town. And these were kind of the surprising results because we were interested in shoreland zoning. And everyone thought that everyone hates shoreland zoning. But not only did we find that people don't hate shoreland zoning, that they would actually be willing to pay for greater restrictions on shoreland zoning, where buffers would be bigger, and they're also supported more inspections and more enforcement because they're in favor of clean water quality. So the other thing that I'll share, this is the summary, the results. Again, both of these are on the Wells Reserve website. And even when we presented the results to DEP and some of our other partners, they still wouldn't believe it. Even though Rob is like, he is an international expert in this kind of survey. And people were still so ingrained thinking that everybody hates shoreland zoning, nobody will support it, that when we said, actually, people would support shoreland zoning. So to wrap it up, back to the mental models. Again, it ain't what you don't know that gets you into trouble. It's what you know for sure that just ain't so. And so in each of our cases, each time, there might have been some premises that were a little bit wrong. But as a result of the research, we found that most people do think like we think as far as values, as far as what's important. But it's just oftentimes they don't know exactly what to do to take action. So it's that figuring out active stewardship, that's the work we're already in. And just don't doubt that people are in favor of what you're working on. And just proceed as if everybody's in your court and everybody's in favor of that, because they might be quiet about it, but you'll be surprised the support you get on projects.
All right, thank you.
So thanks again, all four of you, for coming and presenting. As Chris said, it is one of the most amazing things about getting together like this is to hear the different stories. And so now, as we have a discussion for the next 30 minutes or so, I think one topic is really, what do you as an individual or with your organization have as a goal for working with water? And how does that play out in the work that you do? Or do you want to create goals?
Well, I can share one thing.
Yeah.
In Scarborough, I work about the Scarborough Land Trust. And I'm just standing because sitting is problematic at this hour.
Yes, there's food, so.
When people think of Scarborough, even people in town, they think it generally in terms of, you know, yummy, yowza, natural resources. They think the marsh and the beaches, the marsh and the beaches, the marsh and the beaches, which is great. They're amazing beaches, and the marsh is, of course, the largest in the state. And I realized that nobody was talking about the rivers, which create the marsh. And so that was, you know, I guess it was just a personal priority. Not only because it helped people look upland, which is where our primary, not primary, but where a lot of our properties were. We do a lot of partnering with Friends of Scarborough Marsh. But also because it was just meant to open up people's notion about natural resource values and things of value in town, in addition to the marsh and the beaches, which are always important to be excited about. No one ever wants to be less excited about them because they're so incredible and important. But that's just one thing I've been doing. It's a very simple kind of thing, but you know, there are five rivers that come through town, and I don't think that's really in people's mental map around Scarborough when they think about it, because there's not a lot of drama to these rivers. They're hidden, they're meandering, and the marsh is flat and boring too, so what's exciting? There's no like drama mountain, drama falls, you know, crashing surf unless you're on the shore. So I've been, not exclusively, but it's sort of been one thing I carry in my backpack of conversation about the town and our natural resources, because it's a watery town, but most people haven't been looking up from the coast.
The marsh is not flat and boring.
Oh, no.
I understand what you meant.
I say that it's totally about general public response. It's just, there's like, I mean, everybody knows it's just an amazing, smashingly amazing place. I mean, everybody here, mostly, I guess. But Jane Joe Q public, who don't, you know, who are just on the windshield going on Route 1, it's like, oh, what is this place? Is this a moonscape like in the winter? Because it's brown and flat? And oh, there's green, and oh my goodness, I'm seeing, you know, a white bird now, so there must be something interesting. Or that's interesting, and zoom, I'm gone to the mall now. So it's just, you know, it's not like the Crab's Neck or, you know, a beach or, you know, Acadia, you know, where there's just a drama of a different kind that's not typically American, let's just put it that way.
I have a question I'd like to throw out, which
we've talked about the value of forested land in watersheds for lakes. What's the value of forested land on the upland edge of a salt marsh? Can somebody help me with that?
If it's not much higher, it's a place the marsh can move into when sea level rises.
Well, we understand that. You know, I will have a sea, I will have a waterfront home if I live that long, but and that's not going to happen.
And secondly, it's a riparian buffer.
Much as it would be on the river.
You're in the slides. But your mouth is full. Sorry.
With a full mouth, but no, that wood buffer, that's a water resource right there, right. The marsh. I mean, the marsh itself filters water. But any additional land leading up to that is only bonus for more water filtration. And I'm not an expert on marsh wildlife. Maybe Dr. Fort, there you are.
Yeah.
You may know with any other wildlife species that require that distance to be kept away.
Yeah,
that won't
I think
use
that,
a salt
that
marsh.
Bird data, the 133 species of bird, because it was including the forested areas adjacent to the marsh, because only a couple species actually build their nest in the marsh. The other birds that are feeding there, their nests are in that
forest. Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. There is some impact, there is some interest in maybe changing some of the forested upland areas of the marsh, and I'm just trying to understand what the risk to in that is.
Such as marsh front homes with
no, not necessarily marsh front homes, but some other issues that
habitat management.
Yeah, more habitat management sort of thing.
Do you know what they're what they're trying to manage for? Like creating openings to have
cottontails.
Oh.
Yeah, that's my job. Yeah, we go out and we heavily monitor the areas that we do habitat restoration in. We have a very good relationship with the landowners because a lot of times their viewshed is right on the marsh. And we do a lot of work where you can see the marsh and that land is highly valued at some economic price. But of course we look at it as, okay, you know, we've got people here who really enjoy their viewshed. We have to work really closely with them to see, you know, what they value, as Chris and everyone else has said. But how can we help them understand that as a federal agency, we have values that we also want to see move forward? And so when we do habitat restoration, we have volunteers come out, so we're publicly educating people who come out with us. We are enforcing and we're making sure that the relationship with the landowner is fostered as well. And so that relationship to us is very important. Anyone who sees habitat restoration going on, we encourage them and they don't know what it is or they're worried about it, we encourage them to come talk to us and the refuge manager, Rachel Carson, because we have 5,600 acres from Kittery Point all the way up until Cape Elizabeth and Scarborough.
Right.
And we manage those areas pretty, not heavily, but we do a lot of habitat restoration. And like I said before, water is not our primary concern. It's habitat restoration for our endangered species, and a lot of them include shorebirds. They include birds that nest in marshes, and so that value of the land is maybe economically, I don't know specifically, but from a wildlife habitat perspective, it's pretty important for these birds and the cottontails that we try and manage, although we haven't seen too many. So.
No, we haven't either.
Yes. Provided that there's a big difference in clearing a patch of forest and putting of a home there versus clearing it for habitat management.
Right.
Or
I understand.
Right, and presumably they would not be, they would be looking at the area that the forest does not have any wildlife that is dependent, that is of special concern or rare, that using that particular forest type, I'm assuming that would be done
and
before.
And if we don't clear forest area for habitat management, a lot of people who want to develop or something like that, they come to us and they say, hey, can you do an ecological assessment or something? Or they go to a different organization and say, can you please help us out and kind of figure out, can we do this here, can we not? And oftentimes the landowners are very willing to work with us. It's really inspiring for us, especially younger people coming into this field that is not so
friendly sometimes. It's helpful for us to kind of foster those relationships. And like he said, there is a significant difference between clearing an area for development versus habitat management, and then the processes that we go through are different also.
Are there other groups that are getting into either water-based programming or are interested in doing programming around water, reaching out to partners? Any great experiences to share?
Well, again, this is small, but I'll just put it out there in this sort of idea department. Again, just it's less about sort of conservation than education, I suppose, but I realize that, like, you know, there's spring rush every spring, and who goes to look at spring rush? Nobody goes. I mean, some people do, but in the spring, when snow melt and the rivers are rushing, when water's high in the spring, and there's some really exciting things that can be seen in early spring, as people who are out on the land know. And yet, again, Jane and Joe, the public, don't necessarily know that it's happening. Number two, it can be pretty cool to look at. Number three, never see it because they don't go to it. So we had a spring rush walk this year to go to a couple of places in town that had some cool viewing spots. Again, more around connecting people. You know, it's sort of neat to see, but also connecting people to the water in their world, where it is, and what's happening with it around the year. So I just, you know, that's just another sort of land and water. Where is it? What's happening during the year?
Yeah, one of the things that we thought about in preparing for this gathering is the use of citizen science and the efforts that are being made across the state by individual professors or organizations to work on some particular data collection that might involve people working in their own communities. We actually have a handout of a variety of resources around this idea of doing the water monitoring across a watershed, collecting data in different streams and rivers. And it seems like a kind of really easily accessible approach to connecting both with water, but also this idea of stewardship and sort of how do we really own what's happening and really understand it even more deeply. And some of these projects can be done at all ages and can be done in sort of creative ways, the most recent one being the Friends of Casco Bay's, was it a nitrogen
nitrogen?
Nabbing nitrogen. On one day at the same time, there were a number of sites across the bay where people took a water quality test. And so that brings in a whole bunch of data, and it provides an opportunity for communication. It's a blast of some kind. There were articles about it, stories on the radio. Just Maine Calling on Monday was about citizen science. So, and I know that Maine Audubon does some. Right?
We have about 100 volunteers for every staff person. We have at Maine Audubon. We have about 2,000 citizen scientists on an average year, and that involves things from kind of the brook trout surveys to kind of the lead sinker work that we do. I mean, everything. Yeah, I mean, we couldn't do what we do with staff. We would just be absolutely just stalled, and so. Yeah, we require a tremendous network of volunteers who can provide us not only on an individual site but collectively throughout the state. We can really start to see that landscape fabric of what is going on as it relates to species, or culverts, or all the wildlife work that we do certainly involves water. you know, even if you think about the iconic species of Maine, you know, again, the brook trout, the common loon, the moose, the lobster, the Atlantic puffin, they're all water-based species. And so we can't protect wildlife without protecting habitat. You can't protect habitat without high-quality water. So they all go hand in hand. And all of our volunteers are working, you know, with water themselves, whether it's the piping plovers, the lease turns, everything is regarding that quality of watershed in one way, shape, or form.
What's cool is that's a statewide project, but to think about individual organizations coming up with a question about something in your region, something in your town, in your marsh, you know, and having the idea, you can actually set up your own kind of projects with Vital Signs, which is a website we have it. It's the Gulf of Maine Research Institute. We have some information on it here, but just this idea of another kind of access point at all different levels. Yeah, here now.
An interesting anecdote on the Nabbing Nitrogen Project, which was originally conceived as both shore-based and floating-based. They canceled because the weather was bad, canceled the floating part of it. But I think there were 130 sites. There were 30 or 50 floating sites. And those filled up immediately. And the anecdote is that people with boats just are dying to do something useful with them. They want to play with them, but doing it for a purpose really is a huge leverage. So if you're on a marsh or a lake or on the bay, think about the boaters.
Well, I was wondering about what's the average age of a person who uses land trust land and engage, you know, is. And the reason I say that is that we do something called Drinking Water Week is a 1 week celebration of drinking water. I'm sure you all have it marked on your calendar every year. But anyway, we do some events every year to try to bring the public in, and we do a plant tour, which I know sounds very exciting. But anyway, we don't get a lot of people, and they tend to be over the age of 60, most of them, except for we do bring in some birds of prey, and that brings a lot of kids, parents bring their kids. But anyway, we talked to some of our younger staff and said, we can't get anybody your age to come to any of these events. What do you think we should do? And one person said, why don't you do a tour of breweries? And she's 30, and she said, if you did a tour of breweries, and said, these are all breweries that are using Sebago Lake water, you know, I might go to that. And, you know, it sounds sort of almost silly, but, Pokemon Go. I bet you if you had sites that were on your land trust land, you'd suddenly see dozens and dozens of people under the age of 30 on the land. I'm not proposing that. I wouldn't know how to do it.
They're out there. They're on parks.
I think trying to find... trying to find things that would, you know, I bet if you said, well, we want to do citizen science and have people come and collect samples, everybody would be in their 60s and 70s. And there'd be lots of dedicated people, and they're key, I'm sure, to the land trust health. But how do you engage? I'm not sure. I don't have an answer. It's a question.
Maine Audubon has been doing some things over the years, and Bryce can, you know, probably share more. But they've been doing some things around linking technology with the outdoors, neither one exclusively, but helping to make that bridge in some programs that they put together, and you might want to be in touch with them to learn more.
We're also just using social media. We're trying to use social media more. What are the different ways that people who are younger, what avenues are they already using in terms of communicating, in terms of understanding their world, and how can we be in that framework in some way, shape, or form? And in some cases, the networks, the historical networks, aren't even where people, you know, kind of in that, kind of millennial generation, they're not even looking there to begin with.
They think Facebook is lame. They're long past Facebook,
Right.
It's Instagram
or Snapchat.
Snapchat. And so we're already,
I know a lot of organizations are saying, oh, we have to have Facebook thing, and we have to do, and kids aren't even looking at that anymore.
Right.
My kids just like, well, they roll their eyes if you say Facebook. So.
Well, and even at the citizen science program that was on the radio the other day, I think someone used the language flash mob for some of the citizen science data collection. That, when you think about it, that's really what these on-time, at the same time sampling projects really are. So, you know, I'm thinking about Chris's work and, you know, language. And in fact, you know, on the other end of the scale, I wanted to ask, how many Jane and Joe Q Publics know what a riparian buffer even is? You know, I have to be reminded, actually. And so, you know, I mean, there's a lot of language and communication tools are huge pieces of the picture.
Helen, do you this is just for the scientists in the room speaking about water. As a homeowner, they push real hard if you try to sell a property on uranium in your water, radon, and arsenic. As you're doing tests in nature, do you find those ingredients in the water?
Well, I used to work at the drinking water program, so that was dealing with public water around the whole state, but also private wells. And the Maine Geological Survey tested, I don't know, thousands of wells, and I think the number was 30%, that 30% of wells in Maine have a natural level of arsenic that exceeds what's considered safe for drinking water. But of course, there's no requirements that private wells be tested for arsenic, so that, you know, many people don't realize that their water is high in arsenic. Radon, you know, again, these reason why you hear about radon, uranium, and arsenic is because you're in Maine, and those happen to be elements that are found in Maine bedrock, and therefore, if they're in bedrock, then they're going to, you know, in other states, there would be other contaminants or metals of concern. So that's why you hear about those three.
But that doesn't impact your work in your work.
Well, Sebago, surface water, there are some things like radon is a groundwater concern, but not a surface water concern because it would just go into the atmosphere. So we're required to test for all those things, but Sebago Lake just doesn't have them. So for surface waters, there are other contaminants of concern, but groundwater, those are particular in Maine and particular to groundwater.
With FBE's monitoring projects, we don't deal a lot with drinking water. It's mostly surface water and keeping the water clean for wildlife and for people to be able to swim in and things like that. And so for that, we'd be looking at, you're always looking at dissolved oxygen, salinity, conductivity, which gives you an idea of what the salt content is of the water. If it shouldn't be there, if it should be fresh and it's getting runoff from the road. But then we also test for things like polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons, basically gasoline, all sorts of contaminants like that, but not so much the naturally occurring poisons that occur that you do want to test for if you have a well water.
Thank you.
Are there other land trusts are there any land trusts here who either have formally participated in the citizen science project, either initiated by yourselves or partnering with somebody else who's leading, or members of your land trust that you know are participating in citizen science of any sort?
Well, Acton Wakefield Watershed Alliance does a lot of it. In fact, today they had a youth kayak, you know, go out and do, they have, what is it, the mobile that comes and does...
is it like testing the water?
Testing the water, and they have these little cones they drop in and take sediment and stuff.
I know Vital Science created a project for Portland Trails for invasives, but it didn't really get too much involvement. I think there were like 10 posts, and then it's kind of withered away since then.
And what's Vital Science for people who don't know what it is?
It's with
Gulf of Maine Research Institute hosts Vital Science, and it's a place to post citizen science projects, and there are scientists who are attached to it also, and they can answer questions. Stuff information. Yeah, we have a handout here, and you can get more information there. We'll also send this out with our follow-up email, so you have all these links and sites.
One of the recent issues of conservation biology deals with citizen science. My first exposure to citizen scientists was having volunteers and training them how to, like, this is how you do it, this is how it must be done, turn in the data this way.
But actually, it's that the first article in the issue, it's more than that. Citizen science has actually been really useful, is that people think outside of the box. Is that people in their various fields get sort of like, they have the way that they think. And there's actually, I can't remember the exact example, but it was an astrological discovery based on, from citizen science, because someone was looking at something a different way that most of the astronomers weren't looking at it. And so it's not only just to collect the data, but it's also very useful when people are doing the citizen science, is that we care what you think too. It's not just so you can give us the data and we can do what we do, but it's a good way to make discoveries.
My favorite story on this is about lobster life history. And Diane Cowan founded the Lobster Conservancy and Friendship, had a PhD in lobster life history, Woods Hole, and there was a gap. Nobody knew where the lobsters were between the time they settled out from a planktonic stage until they were big enough to crawl into traps. And she was launching her kayak. She was dragging her kayak down the beach at low tide on this cove and Harpswell. And she happened by a couple of little kids who were turning over rocks and messing around on the beach. And she said, "What are you doing?" She said, "Well, we're playing with baby lobsters. My dad does all day." And that's where the lobsters were. And she developed an entire citizen science program of monitoring juvenile lobsters in the lower river tidal. Based on that one experience, they never asked the local kids.
That's a great example.
So we need to wrap up because it's now 7, but I did want to just hear if we could do sort of a popcorn or go around the room. A question that you have about integrating water or connecting water and land, a question you might have about any of our presenters' information or big picture, or an idea that you think might bring a bunch of different groups together to address a bigger problem together as opposed to on our own. So if people could, you know, think of some ideas, and it may get to also why you came to this presentation, a question that you may still have in your mind.
I can start with myself. Maine Audubon, and as I mentioned, there's obvious relationship between wildlife, habitat, and water. I think to a large extent it was really around, kind of what brought me here too, is also just kind of the idea of just the process. Because I think that we're all kind of dealing with the same set of constraints in terms of trying to reach broader audiences, what's most impactful to different audiences, and how do we bring people together to solve complex problems. And I think that those running themes are the same for all of us. And I just encourage to hear kind of how those different those battles are being fought, so to speak, and by smart people. And I would love to be a part of listening and being a part of that dialogue. So I think those are the things that I know we grapple with all the time. If there's a ways that we can maximize that impact. I think we'd like to figure out how to get that done, and where are those economies of scale, where are those opportunities to share information. Because I think at the end of the day, it's about how to maximize impact. And I think all of us are of this very similar spirit about what that can be done.
I guess when I come to events like this, this to me, there's always the question of scale. And that's really something that I think a lot about. And doing a lot of work with water, sometimes I get stuck in that perspective, as Kevin's saying, of like, okay, here are the mountains, I can draw a watershed and that's my scale. And so how do you bring together thousands of volunteers from the Audubon and those 5 or so rivers in Scarborough that people don't know about and work together, because that's all important. And I just think this is a neat, cool group for that.
Great.
that scale is something I wrestle with a lot. It's like you want to do a big project, but how do you get everybody involved? And maybe what you really need to do is think about the little projects and start to get people involved with little projects that will maybe in time grow into bigger ones.
I'm a great advocate of grassroots citizen science, or just simple volunteering. Picking up trash on shorelines and riverbanks. Doing very simple clipping and basin plans. Things that many hands make light work. Educates many people to make them stewards and make them aware, such as exploring the five rivers, for example, and having a program where you're going to walk the five rivers and inventory. It's some sort of simple inventory. And then you end up with every one of those volunteers has invested in that, and they become supporters. You want to ruin people's lives. They can't drive down the highway without noticing the invasive plants. For example,
I would think land trust statewide would be an exciting and natural resource for citizen science volunteers. You know, if there's a statewide project, you know, mm-hmm. there are like 80 some odd land trusts. But apart from that, I don't know how many. You know, are there many folks? Are there many land trusts working on watershed scale projects, or even watershed in partnerships in a watershed about or for the watershed? You know, I mean, we're all, you know, it's like this municipal boundary stuff, you know.
We are.
You know,
Three Rivers is working on Three Rivers.
Yeah.
We have the Salmon Falls, the Mousam River, and the Ossipee, which goes into the Saco. And so we are right now, we need $10,000 from every single one of you because we have to raise a lot of money because we're working on a 2,000 acre block owned by 6 people and covers both all 3 of those watersheds, essentially. You know, it's really, and from the very start, We at our last meeting had a little review. We're like trying to think of the stories, and we asked one of our founding members to just come up with how did we start, what happened then, and you know, we got together with Tim Smith and we got Southern Maine Regional Planning to help us vision, and we had community meetings and we talked about, one of the things was this Goat Hill to Shapley Pond project, which now we are actually launching, but now we've got to fund $1,666 every day for the next 106 days.
Those are,
I don't know how we're going to do it. So if anyone has any ideas.
But this land she speaks about, think of those big television screens on either side of the walls framing it, are lakes that are very near the land. And it's interesting how the special interest groups, if you will, it has a bad ring to it, but it's very vital. The homeowners there and the lake associations have really stepped up. They have already, in our brief meetings, because we really are just getting it off the ground, we've had pledges of $10,000. We've had pledges of $5,000. So to answer some of the points here, I think the population in some spots is spot on about the water. And these folks are helping us as best they can. It's just an interesting, it's a little interesting area there where that's a special interest group, but maybe we have to now go around all of our towns that we service in our land trust and see if we can raise the money. We're not professional fundraisers, so it's kind of interesting to watch that kind of volunteerism. It's like sort of hanging yourself out there to say to a stranger, would you be kind enough, I don't know you well, but we are going to do something with a watershed. Could you participate. And if we are successful, it's truly a home run for the entire topic here. You know, it's just a fabulous home run. So, end of story.
It's nice because it sort of ends on one of the things you said, which I love, the landscape of hope. It's just this idea of, you know, we certainly are addressing problems, but really to get people around the table and to feel like we're moving forward, we want to create that vision of where we're going. And so the landscape of hope, bringing water into the conversation, is really important. So thank you very much. I'm sorry about the traffic. Thank you all. Thank you to the presenters, UNE. Sophie helped a lot in building out the context of this presentation, so I really appreciate that. And we'll see you again.
Yes,
yeah, enjoy your summer. Yeah.